Good morning. Grace and peace to all of you on this blustery fall day. It is so good to be here together on this day that the Lord has made. And I do rejoice and I'm glad to be back with Edison again this week. I'm Pastor Rachel Wangenhoek, I guess a retired pastor technically, career change pastor, formerly at Bethlehem Lutheran Church where my husband Eric still serves as pastor, and formerly your church secretary, and now on to other things in the financial world. But I'm very glad to have these opportunities to still put my pastor hat back on and share the word and sacrament with you today. Invite you to quiet your hearts and minds and bring yourself together, even separately in our vehicles, into the space of worship as we listen to the prelude. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Our gathering hymn is We Are Called, number 720, and we are singing the first and the second verses of that hymn. Let us pray. Lord of the feast, you have prepared a table before all peoples and poured out your life with abundance. Call us again to be to the banquet. Strengthen us by what is honorable, just, and pure, and transform us into a people of righteousness and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from the book of Exodus, the 32nd chapter. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off their gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he took the gold from them and formed it into a mold and cast an image of a calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be a festival to the Lord." They rose early that next day and offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being, and the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who have brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone so that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them. And of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, "Oh Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring upon his people." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. A psalm appointed for today is Psalm 106, and I'd like to invite you to join me in singing along on the bold verses, and we'll use this tune.
Our second reading this morning is from Philippians, the fourth chapter. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Synecdoche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes. And I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are written in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 22nd chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Once more Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a great wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite anyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him out into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, and few are chosen.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Well, Jesus is not letting up on us again this week. He has been calling our discipleship into account for what seems like forever in the weekly lectionary. This portion of our three-year cycle of readings are known as the parables of the kingdom. And we struggle with these because we are meant to struggle with them, to ask hard questions of ourselves and our discipleship. This week, Jesus reminds us that the grace of God and the challenge of the kingdom go hand in hand. This week we are invited to a party and we are challenged to come with the right spirit, wearing a wedding garment. One is not without the other. Jesus teaches us paradox. Grace is our way into the kingdom of God, and yet God has an agenda for us in the kingdom. But first, the party invitation. God throws a magnificent party. Our life with God begins with the grace of Jesus Christ. Like every strong house starts with a solid foundation, life with God starts with grace. Grace defined by compassion, hospitality, and invitation. God wants us more than we can ever know. God sets a table, prepares the food, and pours the wine. God holds a party in Jesus Christ. Some of you might recall a movie from the 80s called Babette's Feast. It's a story of a famous professional chef, a food artist from Paris. She is somebody who sees people's taste buds as a canvas on which to paint a masterpiece. Babette becomes a refugee in Denmark and takes a job on an island for a strict Christian sect who abstain from anything fancy and fine. Their usual meal is bland boiled fish. They take her in as their housekeeper. She improves their bland fish meals, but they are still simple in keeping with the values of the community. One day, Babette wins the lottery, wins an unimaginable amount of money, and has the option to leave the island. But instead, she uses every last penny to cook for this community the most fabulous meal, one they could not afford or would ever choose for themselves. There was turtle soup and pastry with quail and foie gras. I can't speak French. I don't even know if I said that right. And truffles on top. She serves all the fine wines and expensive cheeses and caviar and other delicious, extravagant food. And when her people first sit down at the dinner table, they have no idea what to make of all this fancy, well-prepared food. They are at first speechless. And as they begin to eat, though, they come to honest revelations of love and grace in their lives and community. Like her extravagant surprise feast for the community, never believing it would ever eat such food, and much, much more. God has extravagant grace for the broken, for the lost, for the undeserving, for all, for you and for me. God throws a party. And we get distracted. Truly, God's party is every moment of our lives as we have the eyes and the ears of faith to behold it. The party goes on even now. And we have a body to bring to this party, but we get distracted by life. We don't see the party. We don't come to the party. Our relationships and our commitments come first before the kingdom of God, before the feast of grace to which we are all invited. In one version of this parable, someone had just bought a cow. The economy distracts us. We're too busy working. We're tired at the end of the day. In our exhaustion and in our worry over our livelihoods and work, we forget to turn to God, who is the one getting us through it all. Another might say, I've just married. Human relationships distract us from God's grace, and we leave God's grace out of our relationships. A young couple has a fight, as couples do, and they blame each other. They blame the situation, and neither looks at their own selves. We need grace to admit that we're wrong, to let go of what we think we're like, and admit what we have actually done and said. No focus on God and God's grace, and we focus on ourselves all the more and dig ourselves in deep. And yet the party is still going on, but we are distracted. But it is not about us. God invites everyone. And by us, I mean the church. And by church, I mean those who consider themselves members of any church, people who consider themselves Christians. God will not cancel the party if we're not coming. Eugene Peterson, a writer and pastor, once said, "We have important work to do, but if we don't do it, God can always find somebody else, and probably not a pastor or church member." The same can be said of any Christian in any church. God has a party for the world, and should we not show up, God will continue to invite more and others, the good and the bad, according to Matthew. God will invite our enemies, the people who strongly disagree with every opinion we hold dear as the gospel truth. God will invite people who have hurt us directly or indirectly. God will invite people we have hurt directly and indirectly. Careful, whoever we dismiss, leave out, whoever we think doesn't matter, will be invited to God's party. The addicts, both the recovered and the not recovered, Antifa and the Proud Boys, the rich and the poor, the hardworking and people who hardly work. We may not seep God's party. Okay. God knows it's not about us. God can continue to find others. God invites everyone. But even then, God has an agenda for the party, and that agenda is the kingdom. The invitation is by grace, but our behavior at the party can be our acceptance of the kingdom or our resistance to the kingdom. Matthew has a way of keeping us on our toes. Matthew shows us grace abounding throughout his gospel, but keeps reminding us that there is God's kingdom to attend to. There is a wedding garment to be worn while at the party, to let our light shine or to not let it shine. it's like being at work or at school and hearing the people around us laughing and telling racist jokes. We don't want to upset the apple cart, but Jesus wants us to speak up and say it's not okay. A retired bishop told a story years ago in the then American Lutheran Church, the ALC. A black family was on vacation in New Orleans, and they were Lutherans, so they went to a Lutheran church for Sunday worship. The church ushers would not let them in and said that they would tell them where their own church was. The pastor got wind of it and demanded the family be let into worship. The ushers won that day, and furthermore, the pastor was fired from the church. The ALC higher-ups removed the congregation from the denomination. If the church wasn't going to welcome in everyone, it wasn't going to be part of the ALC. If we blatantly leave people out, we resist loving another group of people. If we push others aside out of fear or because they make us uncomfortable, can we really say we are at the party with the right garment on, with the right spirit? Matthew would say no. We might be at the party, but our spirit needs to align with God's kingdom. God has an agenda for the party, and it's the kingdom. This parable is not a final condemnation. Instead, it's a reminder and a warning. God has grace for everyone, and God calls to us to have that same love and grace. Are we capable of loving as God loves? Who can love like God, we ask? How can we even start? Start with gratitude for God's love for you, for God's feast of extravagance and beauty. And remember, it is Jesus who rebuilds us, who reforms us, who molds our broken pieces as we are invited back to that party over and over again. Amen. Our hymn of the day is Where Cross the Crowded Ways of Life, number 719, and we're going to sing verses 1, 5, and 6. Let us boldly confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. With confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Gracious host, fill your church with a spirit of joyous hospitality. We pray for bishops, teachers, church leaders, and all children of God as they invite others to your table of boundless grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious host, as creation waits with eager longing for redemption, protect your creatures that are mistreated. Restore valleys, mountains, and pastures, and still and running waters. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious host, as you set a table in the presence of enemies, so bless the efforts of diplomats, international peace workers, and world leaders who navigate conflict. May they proceed with dialogue and understanding so that justice and peace prevails. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious host, let your gentleness be known among those who are weary or ill. Strengthen doctors, medical workers, and caretakers who see to their needs. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious host, when we are quick to judge outward appearance, remind us how you clothe us all in your mercy. We pray for ministries that provide needed clothing and other personal care assistance in this community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious host, we remember those who have died and are gathered at the heavenly banquet. Comfort us with your presence. Assure us of your peace at all times. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We also lift before you all these people and situations that we name, either aloud or in our hearts. We pray today for our neighboring congregation, Burlington Lutheran Church, as they bid farewell to Pastor Bethany Hall Summers, and pray traveling mercies to Pastor Bethany and her family as they move to San Antonio to begin a new call. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Listen as we call on you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we pray in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And at this time, I invite you to peel open the upper side of your communion kit and receive the bread, the body of Christ given for you. Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And I invite you to take your cup and receive the blood of Christ, the blood of Christ shed for you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Again, it was a delight to gather with you, the people of Edison Lutheran, this morning. Just call to your attention the goldenrod colored announcement sheet. And are there any other announcements that need to be shared with the community this morning? And receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our sending hymn is United at the Table, number 498, and we will sing the first verse. Peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.